23. Hear these words. Now when Jesus heard that John had been arrested, he withdrew to Galilee. He left Nazareth and made his home in Capernaum by the sea, in the territory of Zebulun and Naphtali, so that what had been spoken through the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled. Land of Zebulun, land of Naphtali, on the road by the sea across the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people who sat in darkness have seen a great light, and for those who sat in the region and shadow of death, light has dawned. From that time, Jesus began to proclaim, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." As he walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." Immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went from there, he saw two other brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John, in the boat with their father Zebedee, mending their nets, and he called them. Immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him. Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness among the people. This is the gospel of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So, literally, you're just there minding your own business, doing your job, going about your daily routine. And this holy man comes by, a holy man that you had heard rumors about, perhaps even that he might be the Messiah. He comes by and simply says, "Follow me. Follow me." Well, now the scripture says that the disciples immediately left and followed him, which is admirable. But at the same time, even though they immediately left and followed him, I can't help but think, since they were fully human, just like you and me, there had to be a little bit of a life crisis there. Had to be some directional challenge. Where's he taking us? He says, "Follow." Where are we going? What will we be doing now? Those directional challengers or questions that we have from time to time in life. And the early disciples, as they're called here in Matthew chapter 4, didn't have the luxury that we have of pulling out the cell phone or the smartphone. They couldn't Google Jesus. You know, they couldn't look and see and check out his profile and say, "Who is this guy anyway that's calling us to follow him?" They didn't really have what we probably would do today. Well, they didn't know it. But I want to share with you this morning that these early disciples, they did encounter and demonstrate a cell phone faith. A cell phone faith. Now, I know you've never heard of that. It's an unheard of faith. But here's why we need it. Here's why cell phone faith is vital to who we are as disciples and as the church. First, cell phone faith helps to keep your schedule in order. It helps to keep your schedule in order. Now, we don't have to carry around big books of calendars anymore. We have one right here on our smartphones. We can check our schedule if someone asks for an appointment, or if we have an appointment that comes up, it will send us a little notification. All of this happens to keep our schedule in order. And friends, these fishermen here in Matthew 4 were introduced to a whole new schedule for their life. What I mean by that is, I'll say it like this. In today's world, oftentimes, we try to fit God into our schedule rather than asking God to help us form our schedule. You know the difference? We try to fit God into the schedule that we've already established, rather than saying to the Lord, "Lord, why don't you set the schedule for my life? Why don't you guide me?" The disciples followed Jesus. He was the one from there on that was going to give them what they needed in their life. He was the one that was going to show them how to keep things in order. And friends, with all of the noise and conflicting voices in our world today, and with all of the busyness that we have, the truth is we have trouble keeping our schedule, our priorities, in the order that they need to be in. It's difficult sometimes. I can remember on my first circuit, many of you know I started in rural Upshur County. I served six churches on my first appointment. They had preaching every other Sunday. Three churches one Sunday, three churches the next. So one church, three churches had preaching on the first and third Sundays. Three of the churches had preaching on the second and fourth Sundays. Remember, I'm just starting out in the ministry. Now, you would think that the churches that are on the first and third Sunday, that it would be exactly the same. No. First Sunday, Canola Run, 9 o'clock. Rock Cave, 10 o'clock. Straight Fork, 11 o'clock. Third Sunday, Rock Cave, 9 o'clock. Straight Fork, 10 o'clock. Kanawha Run at 11 o'clock. The second and fourth Sundays, I had Center Chapel and Frenchton and Waterloo, and they did the same thing, switch it up. It was a nightmare. I can remember at times, and everyone dreams about their job from time to time. But at that young age, I would dream that I got it wrong. You know, that I showed up at the wrong side of the charge. I showed up at the wrong church and then realized I was supposed to be all the way over on the other side of the holla at another church. It caused panic and fear. It was difficult to keep that schedule straight sometimes. And friends, the same can be said in our own lives. Because of all of the competing loyalties that we have, it is so difficult for us to keep the schedule straight. And no wonder that anxiety levels are at an all-time high. No wonder we live in a society where fear oftentimes is the order of the day. And in a conflicted society, because we're living life out of order. It's the difference between order and being out of order. And we know when something's out of order, it's not functioning right. And when we get our lives out of order, we fail to allow God to be the one who orders, who schedules our life. It makes a huge difference. My wife teaches math, as you know, at Bridgeport High School. And she'll be glad to know that I remember when it comes to the order of operations. You know, mathematical operations. There's a certain order in the equation that you have to approach it with PEMDAS. Please excuse my dear Aunt Sally. Now, we had some other acronyms that we sometimes use that are non-repeatable here in the pulpit. But please excuse my dear Aunt Sally. If you got it out of order, you got the wrong answer. Plain and simple. And friends, I say that to you today. These fishermen were given a whole new schedule. A whole new ordering of life was about to take place. And God invites us to allow Him to order and schedule our lives. I had a friend who had made a commitment to having a daily time of devotion and prayer and scripture reading with the Lord. And he had a terrible time maintaining that. And so, because he was, like many of us, tied to this device, he just started putting it in his calendar every day, his appointed time. And on Sundays, when he was to be in Sunday school and worship, he just wrote in his calendar, God Almighty. God Almighty. Now, I don't know about you, but if I get a notification, you know, 10 minutes before the time, and it says God Almighty, I'm going to pay attention, right? I'm not going to ignore it or dismiss it or snooze it. There it is. Well, I don't necessarily recommend that for you. If it works, do it. But more importantly, find a way to allow the Lord to be the one who keeps your schedule in order, who schedules who you are and how you are to follow. That's what we mean by cell phone faith. It helps to keep our schedule in order, even as Jesus ordered the schedule of those early disciples. Secondly, cell phone or smartphone faith helps you send the message to others. Send the message to others. Now, you know, I know it's harder for the younger generation to truly appreciate that, but I never dreamed in my wildest dreams as a youngster that I could pick up a device like this and send a written message to someone instantly. Through texting, through a snap, through whatever it is. And we sort of take that for granted these days, but there it is, right there. And friends, if we are to be faithful as individuals and faithful as the church, we are called to send the message of Jesus Christ to all people. Jesus said to the disciples, follow me, I will make you fish for people. He was saying to them, I have a larger message, a larger purpose with which you need to be engaged. And you need to be sending that message to other people, that there's strength and nourishment and purpose for life, that there's a love that embraces all people, that there's a grace that can be sufficient for your every need, messages that our world desperately needs to hear today. It's up to us to send that message to other people. I never thought in 100 years that I could swipe my phone, take out my texts, and send right now a text message to someone in the congregation. By the way, I texted, stay awake. I see you back there. Sometimes it's difficult to get that message through. Some years ago, my mom was eating breakfast at Shoney's with a friend. She went up to the cash register to pay. About that time, a cross-country team came filing in to eat breakfast there before they went on to their meet down the road. And all of the cross-country team members went back for the breakfast bar, except for one young man. He kind of held back, and he sheepishly approached the cash register lady and kind of quietly said to her, "I just need to know how much breakfast I can get for $2, because that's all I have." And the cashier said, "Well, what about your coach?" And he said, "Oh, no, don't tell my coach." And my mom did what many of you would do. She kind of winked at the cashier and said, "Well, it just happens that today this young man's breakfast is already paid for." And so she paid, and he was surprised. He looked, and he was surprised, but they didn't hesitate. He went right on back and got in line with the rest of them for the breakfast bar. There's more food than you thought was available. He thought he was short. He thought he couldn't have it. He thought he was going to be left out without food, perhaps, but there it was. And friends, there are many people that you encounter today that feel like that life's left them more than a few dollars short. There are many people that you encounter today that are searching for a source of nourishment and strength for their lives. And we, as the Church of Jesus Christ, are called to send that message clearly, that here is a place that you can encounter a love beyond all loves that can strengthen and nourish your life each and every day. I'm embarrassed at times that we as the church, as a whole, sometimes send the wrong message, whether intentionally or unintentionally. We sometimes send the wrong message. That's easy to do when you're texting. You know, if you're texting multiple people at the same time, you ever had that happen? Had it happen to someone in this congregation some years ago. I got a text one morning saying, "Happy birthday, sweetheart." Well, first of all, it's not my birthday, and secondly, thanks for the nice words, right? But that's such an easy thing. How many times you unintentionally kind of sent the message that you didn't really mean to have toward that person? But friends, on a very serious note, the message that we have to proclaim in today's world is a wondrous message, that following after Jesus Christ can bring you love, and we want you here, we need you here, you're valued in the eyes of God. And we can never be in a position of sending. If I send a message that sends someone away, then I've gotten it wrong. No matter how right I think I am, if I send a message with wrong spirit, then I'm wrong. That's the challenge of the faith. That's the challenge of the Christian faith for each and every one of us. Are we getting the message out to all people? Finally, cell phone faith not only helps us keep our schedule in order and helps us send the message out to others, but cell phone faith helps us to get the picture concerning life. The picture concerning life. Again, never would I have dreamed when I had those little Kodak cameras that I carried around that I could just bring out my phone, my smartphone, and take a picture and have it instantly at my disposal. Who would have ever thought that? Yeah, I get the picture here. Let me go. It still amazes me. But that's what God desires in our life. He desires for us to get the picture, to see it from His perspective, to tune in to who He is and how He would have us live our lives. I never thought that I could just punch a button, and here I am watching the live stream along with everyone else and getting the picture. It's a little bit delayed. Guys, it makes me look a little heavy. Could you pan out? Could you pan out just a little bit more? It probably would help me there. God will do anything to help us get the larger picture of what it means to live a life of joy and light. Isaiah said, "Those who've walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who've been in the region of the shadow of death, on them light has dawned." He will do anything to help you get that picture. And friends, He did. He sent His Son, Jesus Christ, so that we could see who we're supposed to be and so that we could see what's ahead, what awaits us. Oh, my first circuit, an old gentleman lived next to me, and one strong winter day, there was a lot of snow. He was out there shoveling his snow, and as I walked to my car to drive into college at Westland, I said to him, "That's why fall is my favorite time of year." And he looked up at me and he said, "Well, right now I'm cold, my joints hurt, my back's stiff, the days are shorter, and I hate coming out here to shovel this stuff." And I said to him, "Well, what's your favorite time of year?" And he said, "Winter." He did. He said, "Winter." I said, "Did I hear you correctly? What, winter? Why winter? You just gave this long complaint." He said, "It makes me really appreciate the fact that spring is on the way. It makes me really appreciate the fact that spring is on the way." What a great perspective. What a wonderful picture to have. To be able to say in the cold, dark moments of life when we're hurting and we're broken and we're in pain, to be reminded, because of Jesus Christ, spring is always on the way. That's what God wants us to see. Cell phone faith helps us get the picture if we're open ourselves to that faith. In closing, I told them last night, some years ago I had a friend who moved to Pittsburgh. He and his family, at the time he had a 12-year-old and a 6-year-old. He and the 12-year-old had gone up one evening to kind of scout out the house that they were in the process of purchasing. He went with his dad. He'd never been to, little boy had never been to Pittsburgh. It was nighttime. They came through the Fort Pitt tunnels. Those of you who've done this, and I still enjoy it to this day, to be quite honest. You come through the Fort Pitt tunnels, and all of a sudden, boom, there's the lights of the city, the cityscape, just right there in front of you all of a sudden. And it's beautiful there by the river at nighttime. And the 12-year-old was really impressed by that. Well, a few weeks later, it came time for the whole family, of course, to move and to make their relocation. And my friend says that as they approached the Fort Pitt tunnels, he heard the 12-year-old say to the 6-year-old, "Just wait." And he said, "What? What is it?" "No, no, it's just ahead. Just wait." And he kept going. He said, "As they're going through the tunnel," he said, "you're almost there." "What is it?" "You've got to wait." And he said, as they emerged from the tunnel, and again, the cityscape opened up before them, he said he heard the 12-year-old say to the 6-year-old, "Ta-da! Ta-da! Here it is." Friends, our faith in Jesus Christ will assure us of that ta-da of joy. Even when it may seem dark and it may seem that the tunnel or wherever you're traveling right now is difficult. Those who've walked in darkness have seen a great light. Come and follow me. In Jesus Christ, God is saying to us, ta-da, here it is. Here it is in Jesus Christ, my friends, more hope than you've ever dreamed or imagined. Strength for those who are weak, comfort for those who are sorrowful, peace for those who are in chaos, joy for those who are in the depths of anguish. This is the God we serve. This is the God who has revealed himself in Jesus Christ. This is the picture that he wants you to see. And then together, he wants us to walk into and be a part of that picture. May God give us cell phone faith. Smartphone faith, that our schedules might be in order, that we might send the right message out to others, and that we might truly get the Christ-like picture that God has for our lives. Let us pray. Lord, just as you called the disciples of old, so you call to us today. You call us toward a faith that can give strength and joy. You call us to a faith that enters into the depths of our despair and reminds us of the joy that's ahead. You call us to a faith that can encourage and include and engage our world. Give us wisdom to open ourselves and hear as the early disciples heard, "Follow me," and like them, may we respond trusting in you. Through Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen.